day, greetings students. I'm very happy to meet you all again in grade 12 business studies. In the previous video session, we have discussed about staffing process, right? We are in chapter number 6, which is called staffing, and it is the third managerial function that we have discussing. Already we have discussed two managerial functions in depth, which is planning and organizing, right? We are going to talk about the third managerial function, which is called staffing. Now, what is staffing? Staffing is the process of filling jobs and keeping the jobs fit. Both, that is finding an employee for the vacant job and keeping the jobs fit means what? Retaining the job is also, retaining the employee in the same job is also very, very important. It is not that once you place them, your work is over. No. It has to keep on going, that is the job should be always filled. Then we have discussed about the importance of staffing, that is the benefits of staffing. That means it helps you to discover the talents that are in your employees, and it helps you to discover competent personnel for your organization. Why do we need competent personnel? Because the right personnel, the right workforce will enable your business to grow. Right, if your workforce is not competent, if there is something wrong with your workforce, of course there will be a failure in your business. So human resources are considered to be one of the important assets of any business organization. We say that if the human resources are good, then your organization, your business will move towards a success path, whereas when it is not so good, it may even break, is what we studied already. What did we discuss next? We discussed briefly about staffing as a part of human resource management. So what are the various things that is done by the human resource management? Like estimating the manpower requirements, analyzing the jobs, preparing a job description, recruiting, selecting, training, developing, promoting, appraising. Right, planning the career of the employees, various things are there. Then we spoke about the evolution of human resource management, how it came into existence and how it has come to a separate function. Okay, along with planning, organizing, directing and controlling, staffing has become one of the important managerial functions, and it is the only managerial function that deals with human beings. The other resources, talking about physical resources and financial resources, non-living things, right? So even if you know there is a repair of the machinery, you may leave it or you may take some time to repair it, or immediate reparation is possible. But the only resource that has feeling, that has emotions, that has to be even taken care very well is the human resources. That is why we say staffing plays a very, very important role in any management. Staffing actually plays both the role. It plays the role of a managerial function like planning, organizing, directing and controlling. At the same time, it plays the role of a distinct function like production, financing, like that. It plays that role also. Alright, so human resource management, from where did it start? Earlier it was only labor welfare officer and personnel management. And that was even not given that much of importance. Now we have separate stream called HR. Okay, we have HR managers, we have a study, we have a course. You know, to specialize with the human resources. Because handling human resources is really, really challenging. I won't say it is tough. It is challenging. Right, so how it came into existence, how it got developed, how it gained its importance is what we have discussed in the previous session. And then we just saw just about staffing process and what are the various steps involved in staffing. What are we going to do now? We are going to discuss each of the steps in the staffing process in detail. That is what we are going to do now, and we are in chapter 6. We are talking about staffing process. So what is the first step here? Estimating the manpower requirements. structure, and we designed the jobs that has to be filled. We design the hierarchy, right? Based on that, we will design the manpower requirements in an existing enterprise. It doesn't mean that okay, all our staff, we don't have to go further. No, we have to go. What we have to have the staffing function, because already we said keeping the jobs filled. Right, keeping the job filled means what? Retaining the personnel, keeping all the jobs filled. Not anything should not be left out vacant. Already we saw an example, right? Employee 1, employee 2, employee 3, employee 4 means each employee is important. It is not that one employee is not there, means also the work will go on and on. If it is a proper organizational structure, then again you need another person to do it, right? Not the same employee, but some other employee is required to complete that work. Right, that is needed. Fine. So what you are doing first step? Estimating the manpower requirements. That is, what is the job? Which are the positions that are vacant? Okay, what type of professionals do you need? What should be their educational qualification? How many people do you need for each job? Clerks means how many clerks? Office assistants, how many office assistants? Managers, how many managers? What should be their qualification? Do they need to have any experience? All this should be estimated. Okay, let it be horizontal or let it be vertical. You need to design the manpower requirements. So it should match both. Horizontal means what? In each department, that particular employee level is there, means that is a horizontal. Line managers are there, right? They will design it in a vertical manner. That is, all the positions in their particular department is filled or not will be given. And further, they need to think about giving opportunities to some other people, like people who are physically challenged. You know, there are some shops which employ especially these kind of people, or they give chance at least. There are 100 employees working, means at least 5 employees will be physically or visually challenged, or you know, someone from a very backward class, someone like that, someone who needs help will be given. Some management, some organizations, they keep it in their objectives that we have to help the society like this. It talks about the social responsibility of any business organization. They have a rule like this many women should be given the opportunity to work. Child labor should not be allowed in the organization. These also will be part of it. So the staffing function involves all these things. They should make sure that they don't involve any child labor. Because staffing function only is going to recruit people, right? So they should be very clear that child labor is not allowed in the organization. We should give opportunity to people who are physically challenged or visually challenged. How can we employ them? What are the benefits that we have to, you know, make for them? Like for example, if you are going to have a visually challenged person in the computer department, it is not that they cannot do and all, they can do. Right, they are really competent enough to do jobs just like us with little bit of more special qualities. Right, so when you are appointing them in the computer department, nothing, you just have to have a keyboard with, you know, where you have the letters in embossed form. That is, when they touch, they can feel the letters. You know, it is all about practicing. So they would know how to do it even. Okay, you need to give them the headphones, along with the headphones, so that when you have to, you know, get some orders, you can just send them through a voice message instead of giving them a circular. Circular we can give, but people like them, they need it in an audio format, so you can attach it. Special techniques or the special applications that they may need should be installed. This also should be taken into mind when you are designing about your manpower requirements. Why we have to think about it? Because it is part of the organization that is willing to help the society. Okay, because the organization works in the society only, and it needs to take care of its own society then. So it plays an important role in the social responsibility of the business. Right. So what do? We design One is called the workload analysis and another one is called the workforce analysis. Okay, one is called the workload analysis and second one is called the workforce analysis. Workload analysis means what? What is meant by workload analysis? Workload analysis means what is the work that has to be done. Job description is there, right? That will decide the workload analysis. It will assess the number of employees needed and what kind of employees do they need. What should be the skills that they should have. So if you want someone to someone in the transportation department, what are the requirements you think? They should have license, they should know driving, they should be able to manage vehicles, all these things. They should know how to ride a two-wheeler, how to drive a four-wheeler. All this will come into your mind, right? So the skills that an employee must need also should be decided according to the workload analysis. Workforce analysis means how many employees do you already have? Are they competent enough? Do their skills match the job description? Okay, why do we have to do a workforce analysis? Because the company should not be overstaffed and understaffed. Okay? The organization should not be overstaffed or understaffed. How it has to be staffed? It has to be optimally staffed. Okay, this is wrong, only this is right. What is meant by overstaffing? Where you have people more than your requirement. You want only 10 clerks, but when you have 15 clerks, then it is called overstaffing. What is the demerit of overstaffing? You will not be able to optimize them. You will not be able to utilize them in the right way. You have to pay extra. Okay, this cost will have to be incurred, right? And place you need to find for them and all those things. That is the demerit of overstaff. So an organization cannot be overstaffed or understaffed. Understaffed means what? You need 10 clerks but you have only 5 clerks. The work of 10 clerks will be done only by 5 clerks. At that time the quality of the work might go down. There might be a delay. The 5 staff also may feel like overburdened. Okay, at that time they may feel disheartened or demotivated to continue their job, and you have an opportunity of even losing those employees. So overstaffing is also wrong, understaffing is also wrong, and at that time you have to think about optimally staffing, that is the right number of staff should be employed. Okay, with very few extra staff. If in production department you have 1,000, you need 1,000 employees to complete the production. You cannot have exactly 1,000 employees at the time. Because we don't know what might happen. Someday one of them is not feeling well means, and you make them work all 6 days a week means they will not be energetic. They will not be able to, you know, go on and on and on and on with their work. So you might give them a shift basis where you can have some extra staff to replace them in case of emergency and urgency. Right? That is called optimally staff. So as a businessman or a woman or a personal manager, what you have to think? You have to think that your workforce should not be overstaffed or it should not be understaffed. It should be only optimally staffed. This is how you estimate the manpower requirements. You should think about the job description. You have to, by this stage itself, you should figure out the job description. What should be the expectations that you have from your employee? What are the skills they should know about computers? What are the languages should speak? All this will be in the job profile, in the employee's profile. So you should have this goal, job description, and which job profile or which employee profile will match the particular job. This should be decided in which stage? First stage, which is estimating the manpower requirements. What is the next stage? Next you go for recruitment. process of searching for the right employees to fill the jobs vacant is called as recruitment. Especially, you have to stimulate them to apply for the job. It's not that I just go and find like this, I just go and search like this. No, I have to stimulate them to apply. So, for example, when we have a competition in our school, okay, just we are announcing this is a competition. On this particular day, we are going to have a competition. Please, whoever is interested, just join. We just go like that, means it won't work out. But what as a teacher I have to do? I have to come to my children. I have to tell them how interesting is this, what are the benefits of it. Stimulate them, make them feel interested. So it is basically attracting applicants to apply. Okay? Attracting applicants to apply for the job. How do you do it? First, you need to tell them that such jobs are vacant. Okay, you should make the applicants aware that what are the jobs vacant in your particular organization. So, how do you do it? By advertising. What do you advertise? Situations vacant. Already we have discussed it in the previous videos. It should be given advertisement. Like what are the qualifications expected, what are the jobs that has to be filled, how many number of employees do we have, and all those things should be given. Now talking about lower level of management or middle level of management, we need so many employees. But in an existing enterprise or in a new enterprise, the top level management is always limited. Okay, very few people take up the position in the top level management because it requires high managerial skills and it is a very narrow area. In that case, do we have to go for, you know, recruitment and selection? Do we have to go for it? Yes, we need to go for it, because recruitment is what? Telling about the position that it is vacant. Announcing it. Just I need only one manager. I'm just thinking of it. One manager I need. One manager I need. One manager I need. Will you be able to fill the position? No. Still you have to go for the same process. Advertising, stimulating the applicants to apply for the job. Still it should be there. Fine, children. And what next? Recruitment. In recruitment, we actually have two sources of recruitment. One is called the internal sources, another one is called the external sources. Internal and external sources. Okay, we're going to have two sources, internal sources and external sources. These sources will be discussed in detail in aspects of staffing, which will be the next topic. As of now, we are going to just know what is recruitment. Next, we are going to discuss about what is meant by selection. What is the next process after recruitment? You have stimulated them to apply. They have also applied. So you are coming in for a selection process, which through which you find the right candidate for the right job. So it is the process of choosing from the pool of applicants. So many people have applied for the same job. So you have to go and pick out the right people, whether they really prove to be competent, whether they really match the job description, everything. You have to go for it. Especially it narrows down the prospective candidates from a lot of candidates. Just because someone has applied for a job, you cannot give them the job. Okay, even in the top level management as discussed, still you have to go over the process. The interview process will be there. Interview is one of the important techniques in selection. Various things are there. You have a GD, a group discussion, a written test. Lots of things are there which we will be discussing further. But interview is one of the important techniques in selection. Even in top level management, you have to go for it. Why do you have to go for selection? Because it's a narrow scale and only 2 or 3 employees are, you know, applying. But still, you have to go for selection process for 2 reasons. One is that you are going to ensure that the company gets the best person. Okay, out of 3, whoever is best, that person is appointed. Second thing, the employee should feel that prestige. They should feel that Yes, this job is very important. That's why so many processes are involved in it. Like they should feel that sense of prestige and pride that yes, I got selected. It is not that okay, I applied and selected me. In that case, they feel like okay, they do not have any other option. That is why direct selection. So whatever I can do. It's not like that. I went through my proper interview process, proper selection process. They tested me and then finally they have recruited me, they have selected me for their position. I will also feel happy and I will feel the responsibility towards the organization. Right, so it involves tests and interviews as I said earlier. And after that, whoever is able to manage the test, whoever is able to pass the interview, will come in for the organization, will be selected as the employees for the organization, and they will be announcing the date of joining, the compensation, the pay, everything will be discussed. So after estimating the manpower requirement, you go for recruitment and selection, then you talk about what do you do next. You have announced the date of joining. So what will they do? They will come in for the joining. So you have placement and orientation. First, let us talk about orientation. Orientation is introducing the employee to the work environment. Okay? Introducing employee to the work environment. Fine. What is placement? The employee taking up the job. So you have selected the date of joining, you have announced, they have come. Personal manager, as a human resource manager, what do you do? You take them. So this is my new employee. This person has joined this particular department. So many years of experience. These are your colleagues, your immediate superior, your subordinate. If these are the rules and regulations of the company, if you want anything, you can ask this person. This person will help you out. All this, making the employee, you know, feel, giving the sense of belongingness and making them feel comfortable will enable them to work more effectively. That is called as orientation. This is a very crucial process in staffing. Why? Because it has a lasting impact. The first day when they, how they receive you, the first impression is not only the best impression but even the last impression, because however you have impressed them the first time, it stays. Can never be changed. Okay, the first impression is always the last impression, remember that. So you need to introduce your employees in a positive way. You need to welcome them. It's not like, oh, you have joined, okay, go and do your job. They will not have the interest to stay with your company. Right, after so many processes, you have selected the best candidate, and just because you are not ready to welcome them in a positive way, they might leave your organization. Right, in the same sense, if you have just welcomed them and you have given them the freedom, you have let them know about the organization, you have been with them, you have spent some time with them, they will definitely feel happy and continue with the organization. Whereas placement is where they go and acquire the position, they are taking up the job. Okay, my job is an accountant, I have gone through all those things, I have referred my senior accountant, how I have to do everything fine. Finally, I go sit in my place and start my work, right? That process is called as placement. Fine. What do we do next? We go for training and development. But why do we need training and development? As we have discussed earlier, training and development is really, really required for any employee. It should be a new organization or an old organization, or that is an existing enterprise. You need training for the employees because they might be skilled, they might be educated, but you need to make them fit in your particular organization. For that, we need to train them. And it is not a one-time activity. It is a repeated, continuous process. This is also an important aspect of staffing children. In aspects of staffing, we will be discussing about recruitment, selection and training. Okay, these three are for the aspects of staffing which we will be discussing in detail. So training is very, very essential for any employee, let there be a new employee or when the organization takes a new step. You know, when the organization expands its division, introduces a new division, then you need training. So there are two sources, internal training, that is on-the-job training or off-the-job training, we say, that also we'll be discussing. Sometimes the organization itself will train them, okay, in their particular field. Sometimes they will have outside sources to come into our organization and train. Right, for example, handwriting, your teachers train you in handwriting, that our school teachers are training. But when you have to be trained in something else, like martial arts or something else, someone from outside, they come and they train you. So both sorts of training is applicable for you. Just like you, in a broader sense, the employee also has to go through both of these training. Sometimes the in-house training, that is the in the job, the organization will train, and sometimes the other outside sources will come in for training, or even we might go in for some training. I am working as a designer in the organization. So I want to learn a new course. I want to get trained in one particular thing. I can go out and I can go in for some other course and get trained in that particular field. So both training are possible and it is very, very essential to be trained. And there should be a continuous gradual growth in an employee. That is called development. Right, what is development? A continuous gradual growth is called the development process. They should be like that. Like as an employee entered, however he was, after 10 years also the employees of same thing, he or she has not developed any skills, means it's nothing called development in that employee. So that's how, when you know, delegation, decentralization, all these comes up, and when you delegate the authority, you teach them how to do it. They'll learn something new. That is even part of training and development. Right, children? So these are all the five important things of five important steps in staffing process. Okay, training and development, you send them into the organization, fine. Is the staffing process over? No, we have three more steps in this. What are these? Performance appraisal. After the employee joins in our company and gets to work, got comfortable, after a certain time you go for it. It's called performance appraisal. That is how far the employee has improved. Was there any change? Whatever promises given by the employee during the time of appointment, is it kept up? Were there any changes in the behavior of the employee? All those things we have to study. So we have to evaluate the employee's performance. Not the employee on the basis of what? The performance. That is whether he or she is punctual. Everything will fall into performance appraisal. Even in your marks, internal marks we give, right? Based on your notebook submission, based on the punctuality of submitting of what? All these are appraisal, evaluating. Same way, an employee is also evaluated. And based on this evaluation, what happens? The next step happens, which is called as promotion and career planning. So, an employee joined as, the junior accountant. When he retires also, he was a junior accountant. There was no prospect in it and there is no meaning for training and development there. So after performance appraisal, if you feel that the person has really done well, then you go for promoting them. Based on this, they themselves can motivate, employees can motivate themselves and increase or make it their career. Okay, they can design their career. It is very, very essential. Through decentralization, they get new managerial talents, right? So you promote them and you plan their career. Fine. The final step is compensation. Compensations, when you talk about, there are two kinds of compensations. Financial and non-financial, or we call them indirect payments. Payments like direct payments, indirect payments. Okay, direct payments means salaries, wages, incentives, all those things. Indirect payments means like when the employer does not give the money to the employee, but gives it in some other format, like salary. For my employee, I'm paying the salary, I'm paying the wages, I'm paying incentives. Fine. Now I have responsibility, or I have that, you know, affection on my employee. So what do? I have another thing like insurance. I pay for their insurance, or I take them out on a day. I give them a paid vacation. You know, employee of the year and all is selected. At that time, they give them like incentive, like where they give them a paid vacation. They can go to a foreign country along with their family. The expenses will be borne by the organization. That is an indirect payment. Both terms of compensation is available. How it is possible? After the performance appraisal, based on that, it will be given. Okay, so staffing, the human resource management should prepare the compensation plans also, how they have to prepare. And direct financial payments are of two types. Okay, one is time based and another one is performance based. So direct payments are of time based, another one is performance based. For everybody, 8 hours you work. The working hours of an organization is 8 hours. So everybody will get the particular salaries and wages based on the time that they have worked. Half a day, if they take leave, for that half a day the amount is reduced. What work do they do in half a day will not matter. Okay, my production should be 100 units per day. Okay, every day I do the same thing, but on one certain day I have to go home in the afternoon. So what do? I complete my 100 units production in the morning itself. Half a day I've taken leave. Do you think they'll pay for the half a day? No, they won't. That is time based, salaries and wages. When you talk about performance based, you have a nice example, piece wage rate system, right? 100 units is the limit. More than 100 units, if you make extra 25 units, for each piece they pay you extra amount. Differential piece wage system is also based on the performance of an employee, like incentives and all those things. You know, usually mobile companies, they'll have this target. We know a term called target, that is 250 cents they have to sell in a month, means after they sell the 250 cents, that is the base target, you have to finish it. After finishing it, if they are able to, you know, achieve more than the target, they will be given some incentive, that is based on the performance, not based on the time. Alright, so direct financial payments, payments are of two types, based on the time and based on performance. Based on time, you have salaries, wages, and based on the performance, you have financial incentives like incentives and bonus. Or employee benefits are also given. Okay, like this. We have their performance and time as a base, but other than this, there are some other things, some other factors that influence the compensation or pay plans, like labor unions, okay, labor laws, company policy. That is, this is the base salary. Labor law say that 8 hours you get work from an employee means you have to pay this much. You have to follow that also. You cannot pay them lesser than that. And sometimes, you know, trade unions, we have seen in movies and all, where trade unions and the union leader, they go and ask, like, you have to increase our salary this much, you have to give us this percentage of bonus. Based on that also, the pay plan will be designed. Okay? So, staffing as a process deals with what are the various things? Acquisition, retention, development, performance appraisal, promotion, and compensation of the most important resource. Which is the most important resource of an organization? The human resource is the most important resource of an organization. Right, children? And it has to, what we have to keep in mind that the demand and supply, just like the products, goods and services, we have a demand and supply for these resources also. Sometimes like, where you will get enough employees, they will come for campus interviews, right? So that is even a source of recruitment. Okay, fine. And you have to go with training. Each process is important. It is not that recruitment is over, I think. Each process, till compensation, it is important. And once compensation is over, the staffing process is over. For this set of employees, the staffing process is over. For another set of employees, you have to go with the same process. Right, children? So what are the various steps? First, you estimate the manpower requirements. Then you go for recruitment. Then you go for selection, placement and orientation, training and development. Then you go for performance appraisal. After performance appraisal, you go for promotion and career planning, and finally the compensation plan will be decided. Fine. So these are the various steps in staffing process. What is the next thing that we are going to discuss about? We are going to talk about the aspects of staffing, the important elements, like how for delegation we saw authority, responsibility and accountability. Same way, here also we have three important aspects of staffing. What are those we are going to discuss now? For each topic, try to have a concept map or a mind map, and at the end of each lesson, I want you to draw a concept map for that particular chapter. It should be in your classwork, not children. Please make sure that you do. It's for your benefit, for better understanding of the topic. Right. So, the aspects of staffing. So, we have recruitment. Selection, training. Okay. In recruitment, what is the first thing that we are going to talk about? We are going to talk about recruitment. It is the process of finding possible candidates for a job. That is what? Attracting them. That is stimulating the job applicants, possible candidates to apply for the jobs. And we have two sources here. Sources of recruitment. We have two internal sources and external sources of recruitment. What is first recruitment means? It is a process of searching for prospective employees and stimulating them to apply for the jobs in the organization. What is the common technique that we use for recruitment? We use advertising. That is, we tell them, we announce that these many posts are vacant and this is the job description. We look for so many jobs. We have websites even for searching this. Like we have Naukri.com, we have Times Job, like that. We have so many websites even who do this. Where you can, as an employee, as a personal manager, you can go and announce, like advertise. Where there is a separate column in newspaper called classifieds, where you get information on the wanted columns. Based on that, you stimulate the prospective employees to apply for the job. Okay, stimulating, how you will stimulate them? By discussing your salary, by discussing about the incentives, by discussing about the requirement, the job description. Based on that, you invite them. So what are the important steps here? Process of recruitment, identification of the different sources of labor supply, from where you get labor. Okay, from colleges or from, you know, people of that particular area, that you have to discuss. Then assessment of their validity. Really, these sources are really true. From where we get, is it true? How well you will get good employees, that you have to decide. Then choosing the most suitable source or sources, just like choosing the alternate plan of action. Here even you have to choose the best alternative, like where, which source you can rely on. And finally, inviting applications from the prospective candidates. You have two sources, the internal source and external source. Internal source are transfers and promotion. External sources, we have many things like direct recruitment, where we announce in the newspaper, we get them, or casual callers, advertisement. People, they come and like popular organization means they come and give you a resume, like whenever there's a job vacant, you let me know, like that. Advertisement you give, employment exchanges are there, which the website that I told are employment exchanges. Then even government has an employment exchange where you go and register your educational qualification. Then placement agencies and management consultants are there. Campus recruitment is getting very famous nowadays. It's even, you know, colleges, they keep it as an advertising technique, even that so many, you know, big companies come to our campus. They come to a college for campus interviews they have. Then recommendations of employees, present employees, they might, you know, recommend new employees. Labor contractors are there. Then we have advertising on television, web publishing. So many things are there in external sources. So recruitment itself is a bigger aspect. So what we are going to discuss in the next video session, we are going to discuss about recruitment. In recruitment, what we have so far seen. So we have seen what is recruitment. It is the process of finding the prospective employees and stimulating them to apply for the job in the organization is called as the recruitment. Okay, that is the process of recruitment. And what are the various things it involves? The process of recruitment involves finding the sources of labor supply, then choosing, checking their validity, then choosing the best alternate source of recruitment, then finally inviting applications. In that you have two sources, internal sources and external sources. Internal sources means what? From your organization, from the present employees, you get employees suitable for the particular position. That is done through transfers or promotions. Then external sources, you have 10 different sources where we are going to discuss all the external sources. Then we'll be discussing the merits and demerits of internal sources and external sources. What is selection about? Selection, we'll have tests. What is the process of selection we will decide? Okay, what are the kinds of tests that we are going to go through? It's a very interesting topic. Then finally, what are the techniques about training, importance of training and development? What are the various kinds of training and development we have? We have training methods, on-the-job training and off-the-job training. Meet you all in the next video session.